Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this lecture titled Civilization of the Mind, I want to unpack with you this notion of the network society. I want to trace its emergence and key tropes. In the lecture, I will first begin by talking about the emergence of the global nervous system as a concept, right? Following the arrival of the telegraph and the appearance of information networks spanning the globe. Then we'll move on to a discussion of the emergence of this notion of distributed control, right? Which follows from the initially centralized communication networks and emerges from a bifurcation point in history, which we will discuss. Then I will move on to talking about the cultural effects of these networks of distributed control and the formulation of what came to be known as the cyberspace frontier concept. So we'll talk about cyberpunk and the cyber libertarian movement. And finally, we'll discuss, based on all of these different tropes, how the network society actually looks like. All right, so our starting point is the global nervous system concept. And as the Scientific American points out in this piece from the end of the 19th century, the time is close at hand when the scattered members of civilized communities will be as closely united, so far as instant telephonic communication is concerned, as the various members of the body are now are by the nervous system. So we have already the emergence in the end of the 19th century, following the arrival and normalization of the telegraph, of this concept of communication networks, information networks, acting as the nerves of a body, right? Acting as the nervous system of a body. And this body is the entirety of the societal structure until that time. So we have a spillover of information networks in everyday life, and the appearance of narratives of network communication, right? So thinkers start tangling with this new phenomenon and trying to understand the profound ways in which it reshapes society and reality as we know it, right? Here is the New York Tribune from 1845. It is now almost certain that within a few months, the magnetic telegraph, which is literally thought and flies a swift, absolutely annihilating space and running in advance of time, will extend to all the great cities in the Union, so that a network of nerves of iron wire to the distant limbs and members, and will connect these points at the very instant, right? So the interesting question here is how it came to be that we conceptualize networks in such a way. And the corollary is, what are the tropes that emerged with information networks? So we have this notion of literally thought, the emergence of information as separate from matter, the annihilation of space and time, the annihilation of spatio-temporal obstacles over communication, right? The appearance of instantaneous communication and a network of nerves of iron wire of communication channels spanning the globe. So what we start observing here, what emerges, is a metaphor in the end of the 19th century, already firmly established, of information networks as a nervous system, right? A network of nerves of iron wire spanning the globe. And the capitals of empire in that network are naturally understood to be the brain of this globe-spanning nervous system. So this is really important to understand, because by extension, And this is an interesting parallel. You could link the rise of the totalitarian state of the early 20th century, as we know it, directly to the emergence of these networks, right? So, in other words, the totalitarian state in its 20th century form, right? The totalitarian state as we know it from first from fascist Italy, and then after that we have communist Bolshevik Russia, Soviet Union, and then National Socialist Germany under Hitler. It's impossible to imagine a totalitarian state in its form without the telegraph and the radio, and then later television, right? Because this sort of centralization and control is only possible through the emergence of global communication networks, allowing operation at scale. Right? So otherwise you cannot imagine coordination and control operating at scale from a central point. And that's what the totalitarian state is fundamentally. It is centralized management of vast swaths of people. So we have the appearance of this notion of information decoupled from matter. We have a compression of space-time, a global information network appearing, and real-time coordination and control becoming possible. And this leads to the emergence of a new paradigm of information networks. Information networks start remolding not only ideas, society and how we think of ourselves in relation to materiality, but literally also even architecture and the material world. So if you think about the skyscraper is possible only insofar as you have a telephone connection, right? Allowing instant communication between floors. Otherwise, it would be an impossible form of building to operate. So we have a complete reshaping of the material world, and which naturally gives birth to new ideas and metaphors about space, with the key tropes being control and communication. And we will unpack this now. So this is the context in which Marshall McLuhan, the originator of the famous dictum, "The medium is the message," also exclaims that the new electronic interdependence recreates the world in the image of a global village. That new electronic interdependence he talks about is that very same global network of nerves of iron wire spanning the globe. When he tries to imagine the world as a village, he literally actually points at this phenomenon of the presence at hand of everyone on the globe, made possible by information networks. Why? Because messages become intangible, right? They stop being material. Information is decoupled from matter. And you have the first trope appearing here, which we will return to again and again in our exploration in this lecture, of the emergence of the network society, this trope of the extraction of information, the extraction of mind from matter, from body, right? And we see it emerging again and again. There is this logic of extraction and processing, right? Which is the native logic of information as such, right? So extraction, processing, sorting of information. This is the main and primary task, and we will return to this concept again in another lecture, when it comes to information networks. So the moment information networks are normalized, these tasks, these types of operations become primary, they become dominant. And we see this emerging as a reaction also to the arrival of the internet 100 years later. So, and we will return to this text down the track in this lecture. So here we have Esther Dyson and Alvin Toffler and other thinkers connected to the emergence of the early internet, declaring that the powers of mind are everywhere ascendant over the brute force of things, right? So what else is this if not the emergence of this exact trope that our ancestors first spotted with the arrival of the telegraph, right? Information decoupling from matter. This separation of mind and body emerges very forcefully, and we will encounter this later in this lecture, with the arrival of a cyberculture, specifically cyberpunk, right? The logic of extraction. At the same time, we have the compression of space-time, which also leads to the challenging and the transgression of geographic borders and jurisdictions, right? When it comes to specifically the role of the state. Literally, the trope that emerges here is of a network which may have started locally initially in the United States, the first telegraph networks, then spreading over Europe and then spreading over the globe. But the point is that these networks are by their very nature global, right? And the information which flows across them is also by its very nature global, independent of individual places, right? Separation of mind and matter again. So the following trope that emerges is this notion of a circumvention and obliteration of borders, which also is related to what we discussed in another lecture, the standardization of global time, the emergence of weather reports and the notion of the global weather, the homogenization of space as such, right? Space becomes landscape to be traversed by information networks. So these are profound changes, the homogenization of time and space. Then we have the appearance of real-time coordination and control over a new kind of space beyond material borders in an environment of quick exchange of information. And I want to spend a little bit more time talking about this, because this is often poorly understood. Coordination and control are of fundamental importance for any complex form of organization. And it is not accidental that our ancestors thought of the first information network spanning the globe as nerves in the body, right, as a nervous system. And of the society spanning the globe, these empires of the 19th century, as bodies. Why is that the case? Because the human body is a great example of coordination and control in real time. So the key thing to understand here when it comes to communication, and we will be encountering this trope again and again, is that the real-time coordination over distance allows operations at scale. If you have the ability to coordinate the movements of your organization, whatever that organization might be, the military was the first to make use of this at scale. If you have that ability, then you can operate it at a massive scale. You can operate at a continental scale. And at the same time, if you have the ability to control in real time your organization, this leads to the ability to operate at speed, right? You can operate at speed tremendously faster than other organizations which do not have that ability for real-time control, right? So coordination and control are like the two sides of the same coin. And the trope that emerges is coordination at scale, globally, and control in real time, globally. And this is best illustrated with the way the military was adopting this at that time revolutionary information technology. So we see the American Civil War in the mid-19th century deploying the telegraph at scale. Both sides were using it in order to move forces in a continental front in North America. We see this in Europe in the Franco-Prussian War. In the end of the 19th century, again with the telegraph, with both sides, the Prussian side much more successfully deploying the telegraph to coordinate and control at scale. Again, this appears together with the radio in the First World War and to a devastating, absolutely effect in the Second World War as deployed by first the Germans and then everyone else. when it comes to the telegraph, radio, and then later television. So, infamously, the Germans pioneered this notion of the Blitzkrieg, the instantaneous war, which stood for coordination at scale of vast forces in order to overwhelm a specific point in the enemy's defenses and control of the maneuvering of your own army's forces at breakneck speed, hence Blitzkrieg. And the Germans were able to utilize these tactics to a devastating effect, first in the in 1914, their campaigns in Western Europe, and then in 1941, their campaigns in Eastern Europe and in the Soviet Union. So we have the appearance of coordination at global scale and the ability to exercise control in real time over that scale. Naturally, this leads to the appearance of the problem of control at scale. The problem of control as such, as a phenomenon, is asked. And the person to ask it was a legendary scientist, Norbert Wiener, who was involved in pretty much all the big military projects by the United States in the Second World War, and is considered the father of cybernetics, because he, in 1948, this is the same time, remember, that Vannevar Bush was dreaming of the Mimex, and the same time that Alan Turing is writing his book on artificial intelligence, and whether machines can, his article on artificial intelligence, whether machines can think. Norbert Wiener is writing a book called Cybernetics, or Control and Communication in the Animal and the Machine. This emerges immediately after the Second World War as a reaction to this phenomena that were first observed, right? Coordination and control at scale and speed over space and time. And in this book, Norbert Wiener asked for the first time the question about the role of feedback in complex organisms, in humans or animals and machines, and theorizes the role of feedback as part of a system of cybernetic control. And cybernetic itself, he takes from the Greek kubernetes, which means steersman, someone who controls something, right? Someone who steers something. So cybernetics is, well, the very word cyber stands for control here in Greek. So he follows that with the human use of human beings, where he uses the same tropes that he first charted in the book that he published 2 years earlier, and deploys them to human society itself, and to the way, again, feedback and organization and knowledge and reaction to stimuli perform themselves in human society. So we have the emergence of the science of control as such, which leads us to the second part of this lecture, and the transition from centralized control, from networks of nerves of iron wire, their limbs spanning the globe and their centers being the capitals of global empires, to a radically different paradigm of distributed control. So the beginning of that journey is the appearance of the mainframe. And the mainframe is nothing more, nothing less than a central computer, central processing unit, which serves to process information and serves as the core of a system of control and coordination. And these first computers, these first mainframes, and they were called mainframes because they were the mainframe in a system of control and coordination, they were used as highly centralized data processing units. And how this operated is that you had multiple, as they were called, dumb terminals spread wide across the network, connecting to one mainframe computer, which was performing the calculations for them. And this is a highly centralized system. And the first computers, by the way, the term was used, in fact, starting with the Second World War, the first computers were human. They were usually women, just like the first telegraph operators and the first telephone operators were women. And they played the role of human computers. So here you have from this image, from the NASA Langley Research Center, 1947, immediately after the Second World War, the operation of human computers processing information. So these were highly centralized networks, star-shaped, because all the different nodes, all the different terminals registering stimuli lead to a central mainframe, to a central computer, which processes those stimuli and issues commands for coordination and control. So it's a highly centralized, highly hierarchical, because all these nodes are subservient to the central, to the mainframe, and highly efficient, because information flows in a very simple, very predictable, very easy to manage way, right? Usually hierarchical centralized systems are highly efficient because of that simplicity of operation. So this is a star-shaped topology. And the classic example here is an IBM mainframe, which is around 2,000 square meters in size and weighs 275 tons, and from 1958. And it looks like this. So these are corridors and corridors of processing power. All of this that you see is actually the inside of that computer, IBM ANFSQ7. So this was a combat direction center for calculation of air defense probabilistic solutions, and it very much was fitting very well with the very topology of how the military operated, in a very hierarchical star-shaped topology, where all decision making was centralized and was flowing from top to bottom. And IBM was the company par excellence at that time. This is the 50s. For computing, and this is an apocryphal example from this time, where the CEO of IBM at that time was actually prophesizing that he can foresee a future where the whole planet would need only 5 computers for all of its coordination and control and information processing needs. And the key thing to understand here is that no matter how ludicrous this sounds to us now, in an age of a totally distributed information processing, and where everyone has a powerful computer in their pocket, this future that the CEO of IBM was prophesizing in the 50s was not impossible. Everything could have turned out differently. Everything could have turned out that way instead, because, as I said, this was a highly efficient centralized network which allowed communication and the coordination of and control over vast distances. So the other interesting thing here is that when you have it's really hard to think in these terms, but when you have this kind of technology, and that these are the only technologies for that matter that you have, the way processing power is organized, all your social structures will be organized the same way, right? So when your computers are the size of football fields, then the social organization will be similar. And conversely, when computers are the size of mobile phones, the social organization will change as well, right? This is the really important thing to understand here. So here we have 1956, how a 5 megabyte IBM hard drive looks like, the unloading of the hard drive from an airplane. Look at the size, and that's a 5 megabyte. Remember, we live in a time where just an average image, an average meme or GIF is often more than 5 megabytes in size. To put things in perspective. So again, reminder, these were star-shaped centralized hierarchical networks. And these networks replicate the network topology of the telegraph and telephone network. So these are centralized switch networks, and I keep focusing on the topology because it's fundamental to understand. In the typical telephone switch network from that time, the different nodes had to connect to the central switch, to the central processing unit, as it were, in order to be able to connect to each other. So if node A in this diagram wants to connect and exchange information, speak to, for example, node B, that connection has to go through a central switch, which has to facilitate it, right? Has to perform it. And the switch may or may not allow it, right? And if something happens to the switch, then all connections in that network become impossible. It ceases to exist. And a reminder that how a telephone switchboard looked like. So here we have a switchboard from the end of the 19th century, one of the earliest switchboards. You see here in practice how the role of the switch actually is performed here by humans who have to physically connect one node with another, right? By moving cables, by moving switches, hence switchboard. So their role was later automated, of course, but the key to understand is that the network is entirely at the mercy of that processing center. And when the computer network started modeling itself and replicating the telephone network, it led to this sort of centralization as well, right? So we had the emergence of these behemoths of computing and communication. So in the United States is the most developed country at that time. So IBM was controlling computing. So IBM was controlling the mainframes and the local extensions, the nodes in the network, and AT&T was connecting connections, right? So it was controlling connections between the nodes and the hub, between the nodes and the mainframe. And of course, we already emphasized that these networks are highly efficient because of their centralized and hierarchical nature and because of the way information flows between the nodes and the center. However, the arrival of Sputnik 1 and the arrival of weapons, right, rockets designed for nuclear warheads, which are able to hit targets anywhere on the planet and wipe out these central processing units in the communication networks, was a bifurcation point because it led to a dramatic shift in the paradigm. And that shift was necessitated by the question posed by Sputnik 1 and that type of technology: how to preserve information flows. And the genius of the solution here is that question was reframed into a problem of network topology, right? Because remember, the network topology we've been discussing so far is highly centralized networks, right? First the telegraph, then we have the radio, the telephone, and the first computing networks. And the solution proposed by Paul Baran, we already talked about this in another lecture, was the ARPANET concept. So this is a network with no central hubs whatsoever, right? Designed to operate while broken. Designed, in fact, to be operating while unreliable at all times, while communication breaks down continuously. And that topology was a dramatic denial, if you will, of the centralized shape, right? This was a fully distributed topology with no center and with a multiplicity of connections between the nodes, which where each node can speak to each other node on the network independently of some sort of central switch. And what changed here, and this is really important to understand, is that something had to be sacrificed, right? So in order to be able to maintain coordination, the center had to be removed and control had to be given to the end nodes. So we have distributing control to maintain coordination in the network, to maintain the network as such, to maintain the ability to communicate at scale. So control had to be distributed to the end nodes. And this is, to our ears, steeped as we are in that paradigm of distributed control, this sounds tautological almost. This sounds like an obvious solution. But you have to understand that until that point, this notion of distributed information flow was unthinkable. It was unprecedented in a communication system, right? Because how would nodes know how to reach each other? Question one. Question two, how would you know that nodes would not act with malicious intent in the network, right? How would you know that they would have something to say that is valuable without some sort of center, without some sort of authority in the network, right? The central hub, being able to filter all this traffic and process it in real time. And what is crucial here, and what is at the very essence of that shift, is that each individual node can broadcast to the entire network without central approval, right? Without an authority figure within the network, the central hub, the mainframe, etc., etc., allowing that communication to appear, right? Without that central switch. And Paul Baran's communication is a dramatic change from your typical telephone network operation, because now each node is a switch as well, right? So we have departed from the very simple star-shaped topology where you have nodes acting as dumb terminals, sending signals to the center for them to be processed and spread across the network. Instead, each node is a switch in its own right and can shift information flows and process them, right? Leading to a situation where you could remove, let's say, 2/3 of the nodes and communication would still be able to flow through that crippled network, right? And this was the intention of Paul Baran's proposal. And what emerges here is a very different space from the hierarchical, centralized, and efficient space populated by the likes of IBM and AT&T, because we have a very anarchic situation where information flows can go anywhere. And it's really important that you understand that these characteristics are not something that is accidental. They emerge from the topology itself. That's why we are focusing so much on that, right? So the anarchic element here is ever present because the topology itself necessitates leaderless, if you will, or authority-less flow of information, right? It's improvised because information flows can change in any direction. There's no central plan. There is no centralized oversight, no overarching design. Anyone can add additional nodes, and all solutions are ad hoc patches, right? The network grows, expands, or contracts for that matter, organically. And we talked in another lecture about the key protocol for that network, right? That emergent network that we now call the internet, the TCP/IP protocol, the transport control protocol / internet protocol from 1973, proposed by Vint Cerf and Bob Kahn, which basically allowed that network to, as it were, speak to itself, right? To start operating. So we have messages divided into packets, each packet finding its way through the network individually, the route itself being irrelevant, unimportant. So packets forming one message could travel through vastly different paths in order to reach their destination. The protocols are technical and do not concern the content, so any sort of content can flow over this communication network. and all nodes can broadcast, all nodes can speak to each other. So, in effect, we have the emergence of a very different paradigm here, where all decision making, all that processing power, which used to be centralized in a mainframe of the size we saw earlier in this lecture, all that decision making is now forcefully pushed to reside with the ends, with the nodes in the network. And the middle itself, right, the middle being here that figurative space where information flows, becomes non-specialized, it becomes indeterminate, right? It's just a place for flows of information. All nodes are paradigmatically equal, right? Because all nodes might end up having to process and reroute information, right? Remember, this is that ideal conceptual network that we're talking about. And to understand the importance of this proposition here, that the network itself is, the infrastructure of the network is independent from the content running over it, is just to think about the telegraph or the telephone or the radio for that matter, where you cannot have several conversations running at the same time over that one cable, over that one wire, right? Over that one frequency when it comes to radio, right? You cannot have several different layers of content operating simultaneously. Not so with internet, where all communication is dropped into packets and trillions, quadrillions of different packets are simultaneously running over the network, right? Content completely independent from the infrastructure over which it runs. And so we have a situation, again, where control is distributed to the end nodes, to the users, and information is infrastructure neutral. And from our perspective, the key question now that we have established the emergence of these phenomena, the key question is, what are the cultural implications? What are the cultural tropes emerging from this new communication paradigm? Because at this stage, it's undoubtedly an axiom that this is a new paradigm, and then there is a shift emerging immediately after the proposal by Paul Barron. So we have in 1973 TCP/IP emerging, then we have the first computers, and then we have the appearance of the internet, and we are where we are right now in 2020. So what are the cultural tropes emerging from this paradigm? And this brings me to the next part of my lecture, of this exploration of the network society paradigm, which is the emergence of this concept of the cyberspace frontier, and the concept of cyberspace itself as a space, as a non-place, which exists in information network and networks, and as such is both everywhere and nowhere. Cyberspace and the cyberspace as a frontier, as a place of opportunity, here using that metaphor of the American Wild West, of the American frontier, a place of opportunity and a place of freedom, more importantly. So cyberspace emerges as a concept in the work of science fiction writer and father of the cyberpunk movement, William Gibson. And it emerges in his novel Neuromancer, which was published in 1984. So here is how he describes cyberspace. Cyberspace, a consensual hallucination experienced daily by billions of legitimate operators. A graphic representation of data abstracted from banks of every computer in the human system. Unthinkable complexity, lines of light ranged in the non-space of the mind. Clusters and constellations of data, like city lights receding. So where is cyberspace? It is in the non-space of the mind. And at the same time, it is a consensual hallucination experienced by billions of people. So every time you catch yourself staring at your phone, doing something on social media, or watching something on YouTube on your laptop or on your computer, or watching TV series on Netflix, you are actually physically performing what William Gibson described in 1984 in Neuromancer, before the appearance of the internet or the World Wide Web, as cyberspace. Because you are enacting that consensual hallucination, a graphic representation of data ranged in the non-space of the mind. Here is how 10 years later, after the internet has already appeared, after the World Wide Web has already appeared and has been operating for 3 years, this is 1994, Esther Dyson and Alvin Toffler and George Gilder and George Kayworth are describing cyberspace. More ecosystem than machine. Cyberspace is a bioelectronic environment that is literally universal. It exists everywhere. There are telephone wires, coaxial cables, fiber optic lines, or electromagnetic waves. So do you recall that exclamation in the mid-19th century when the telegraph first appeared? Thought, nothing but thought. And here we are, 150 years later, and we have these prophets, if you will, of the early internet exclaiming that cyberspace is a universal bioelectronic environment. So it mixes humans and our wet tissue, if you will, our brains, our minds, with these nerves of iron wire spanning the globe. Telephone wires, coaxial cables, fiber optic lines, or electromagnetic waves. Right? And so it's both everywhere when it comes to it's rich, and it's nowhere because it's to be found only in the mind. More ecosystem than machine. And we have John Perry Barlow 2 years later in his prophetic document, A Declaration of the Independence of Cyberspace. We'll return to it in a moment in this lecture, exclaiming beautifully, "I come from cyberspace, the new home of mind." So let's take a step back now, because we have the emergence of this concept of the cyberspace in 1984 in the work of William Gibson, but it does not appear from nowhere, from a vacuum. It does not exist in isolation from developments which are happening at the same time. And these developments are tied to the evolution of this concept of the ARPANET and the evolution of that movement, which started from the bifurcation point, from the satellite, and the necessity of creating a distributed network of distributed control and coordination, which led to the appearance of miniaturization and the personal computer. So we're taking a step back, or rather a step to the side now, from this discussion of cyberspace as a concept to the emergence of the personal computer. Because this is the time, the arrival of the personal computer, where those nodes, which until recently were completely disempowered, they were dumb terminals in a star-shaped topology, those nodes are now starting to act as fully fledged members of a distributed network, where they can process and switch information flows. So the first personal computer on the market is the IBM 5150. Naturally, it's an IBM, in 1981. But it is aimed mostly at offices, at large corporations, so it doesn't really percolate into many homes, and it doesn't really kickstart the revolution proper. At that time already, however, we have the arrival of miniature hard disk. So here we have an example of an ad from Byte magazine. So these are one of the first computer magazines from July 1981. So it's the same year where the first personal computer appears on the market. And it's a hard disk from XComp, 10 megabytes for $3,400. So in today's money, this would be probably around $15,000, counting for inflation. Reminder, 1956, this is 5 megabytes worth of hard drive. Here already have twice the space and many times over reduction in terms of size. And then next year, the year after that, we have the emergence of the first popular personal computer to hit the market and to really kickstart the revolution, as it were, of personal computing and the arrival of the internet. So that's the Commodore 64. It's a legendary computer, specifically when it comes to hacker lore, because it became the hacker choice when it comes to computer machine in the early internet. So it was very lovingly immortalized in early internet lore. And 2 years later, 1984, that's the same year in which William Gibson publishes Neuromancer, we have the appearance of the Macintosh 128, which brought on the market a graphic user interface, the GUI, right? The representation of that non-space of the mind in a visual format, right? So the appearance of icons and cursor and folders and files, right? So this graphical representation of this space now allows much more easier adoption of the computer by millions of people. Concurrently, so far these are computers which can process information, but they still cannot connect to each other. So to do that, they need yet another invention, which is the modem, which allows computers to use the telephone network to communicate with each other. Right, so computers piggyback on the telephone network while using completely different protocols for communication. And the first modem that hits the market and becomes popular is the Hayes Smart Modem, 1981, the same year as the IBM PC. And we have a revolutionary environment, because we have the personal computer appearing as a device which can process and sort information and transmit and communicate with a vast network, plus the ability to communicate thanks to the modem and the telephone network. And we have the arrival of cyberspace as such. And cyberspace first manifests itself as the bulletin board systems. And the key thing to understand when it comes to the appearance of the bulletin board system, or the BBS as they became lovingly known, is that no one imagined that this is how the internet will end up looking like. This is the nascent internet. It's just appearing. This was the people's network, truly, where every node is created equal and every node can communicate with every other node. So the internet as we know it today is very much different and has changed profoundly from those early days. Because those early days are exactly as prophesized, exactly as described. And you will see the description, the enthusiastic, almost utopian from our perspective, descriptions of this non-space of the mind, right, of cyberspace. Because everyone can contribute on equal terms, everyone could communicate with everyone else. So we have the appearance of the first bulletin board systems, or we could now describe them as forums for information exchange. So we have December 1984 FidoNet appearing. A critical new age of computerized information exchange. Electronic bulletin board, easy to use, employing space age wizardry that can help a community to become tuned in tune and self-aware. So FidoNet, or FidoNet if you want, is a user group, and it is a newsletter, and it starts that revolution you could call it the first stage of the internet, the bulletin board system. So this is the first FidoNet newsletter from 1984. Remember, this is the year in which the Macintosh appears. The Commodore has been only for 2 years on the market, right? So everything is just beginning. Everything is only getting started. And Look at how the Tom Jennings, the author of this first newsletter to potential members of that bulletin board system, how he frames it. All articles are user submitted, anything and everything, as per usual protocols, which isn't saying much. Ideas, problems, questions, tips, programs, hardware, etc. are all welcome. Right, so here you have the emergence of this metaphor for the frontier, because anything goes. This is free space, literally. The format of this thing is totally ad hoc. Please make recommendations as to formats, sections needed, liked or hated, columns you'd like to see or see removed, anything at all. If you want to submit something regularly, we can start a column for you. You are encouraged to send things in for the newsletter. Anything is fit for the newsletter. Right, so what this is a call for information. Just please feed that bulletin board information, right? And a reminder, right? So this is a network which is designed to be anarchic, without central plan, without centralized oversight, without overarching design. And you see how the topology starts enacting a type of information, a type of sharing, a type of community, which very much resembles it, because that community is anarchic, fully improvised, and those communities, in fact, because we have a myriad of bulletin board systems appearing, without central planning, without any oversight. And that anarchic nature of the community starts being celebrated, right? So here we have quite famous hacker bulletin board, Babylon 4, which was attended by many of the famous hacker collectives of the early internet, and we'll return to this in another lecture. And this is all about freedom of speech and anarchy, as if you can see here in the text. A new kind of space beyond borders, right? Beyond the material itself, involving free flow of information and thought, nothing but thought. So let's return now to cyberspace as defined by William Gibson, and see how this trope develops and where it goes. Because this is a definition which presupposes the appearance of a space completely independent from the boundaries and potential obstacles that materiality could impose on it, right? It's a known space of the mind. And William Gibson writes this novel actually as part of a competition for starting science fiction writers, and he had a year to finish it. He writes this novel and it starts a revolution. It starts a brand new cultural movement, an underground movement, which is growing with the growth of the internet, and its ideals, its cultural tropes, its aesthetics, if you will, end up becoming the ideals and cultural tropes and aesthetics of the early internet. So this is the cover of the first edition of Neuromancer in 1984, and you can see how the artist has really struggled to illustrate cyberspace, because how to illustrate it, right? Here you have this weird face of an alien creature, which actually there's no aliens in the book, but clearly the artist struggled to illustrate the tremendous fiction and the tremendous change that actually was prophesized in this book. And I'm struggling to describe this because the book in question, Neuromancer, is something everyone should read when it comes to the interest in the internet and interest in digital media, but also it is a book which has the rare honor of changing the world successfully, to the extent that it's easy to say now, 40 years later, that we do live in a cyberpunk environment as prophesied by William Gibson in 1984. And the language that he started using, and you know, that again, this is the book that started the entire movement, ended up starting an aesthetic movement as such. So here we have the sky above the port was the color of television tuned to a dead channel. There is an aesthetic element here of material decay, and at the same time of infatuation with electronics and infatuation with digital information and digital networks. So cyberpunk is born, a new aesthetic. And that same year where Neuromancer appears, that's 1984, we have Mondo 2000 starting, which was a magazine which also formed part of that new cyberpunk movement. And look at how the cover actually captures the key tropes which form that aesthetic uniqueness of the movement. So we have a user's guide to the new edge, cyberpunk, virtual reality, wetware, designer aphrodisiacs, artificial life, techno-erotic paganism, and more. A few years later, another famous, at that time, completely unknown, of course, science fiction writer Bruce Sterling publishes an anthology called Mirror Shades, which gives another boost, another impetus to cyberpunk movement. And then finally, Neal Stephenson publishes what ended up being one of the most popular cyberpunk books, called Snow Crash in 1992. So this is a year after the World Wide Web appears. And cyberpunk goes slowly but surely mainstream with the going mainstream of the internet itself. So we have Wired magazine emerging in 1993 with its first issue having Bruce Sterling on the cover talking about the future of war, but also we have McLuhan being discussed here, and digital sex and all sorts of other cyberpunk tropes in effect. A few issues later, we have William Gibson on the cover with his journey to Singapore and description of Singapore and Hong Kong. And again, cyberpunk tropes appearing and driving forward this imaginary, fascinating new network, fascinating new medium appearing. And you can see here on the cover of yet another Wired magazine, we have it in our power to begin the world over again. And what has happened here is that we have this charismatic new movement appearing from California, the Western United States, proclaiming that everything has changed. We live in a new paradigm, and the rules are different now, and there is this new space of freedom, which we call cyberspace. And you better be aware of it. And that same year, where the first Wired issue appears, that this 1993, remember, the internet appears in 1991, right? The World Wide Web appears in 1991. And 2 years later, we have Time magazine already starting to normalize this fascinating new movement for the masses, right? Cyberpunk, virtual sex, smart drugs, and synthetic rock and roll. A futuristic subculture erupts from the electronic underground. And this is fascinating, because what does this tell us? There is already such a thing as the electronic underground. So these are people who have for 10 years operated in an underground of cyberspace on bulletin board systems, generating these weird ideas. And they're doing all these weird things that we don't understand. For some reason, they're interested in things like virtual sex and artificial intelligence and transhumanism. It's a futuristic subculture, right? And it erupts from that electronic underground on an unsuspecting material world, right? Erupts claiming victory and possession, as it were, over that unsuspecting material world, while declaring that they come from a space of the mind, of freedom. And what are the tropes of this new movement? We have clearly the separation of mind from body as a fundamental trope here, right? Because cyberspace is a consensual hallucination, right? It's in the mind fundamentally. We have artificial intelligence, we have cyborgs, we have body augmentation, right? The ability to control the body through information networks. We have transhumanism, virtual sex, body augmentation, I mentioned virtual reality. We have the glorification of the hacker as a cult figure in that movement. And the aesthetics of urban decay, which come with cyberpunk. So there is a fascinating mixture here of romantic tropes from the 19th century, which percolated also around the arrival of the telegraph and re-emerge now with the arrival of the internet, of this radically new information system, this radically new network spanning the globe. So again, a reminder that these phenomena, these cultures are interesting because they appear as a function of the way the internet was conceptualized and designed, as a function of the way these distributed control networks were imagined, right? A network independent from the infrastructure over which it runs, where decision-making resides with the nodes, and nodes are created equal and can broadcast to the entire network. So simultaneously with cyberpunk, literally simultaneously with cyberpunk, we have a new movement, a new idea rather, forming, which in many respects is an old idea, the idea of freedom, the freedom of speech, but here translated and at the same time hypertrophied in many respects into the idea of cyber liberty, right? The idea that this new space, this cyberspace that we're describing, is a space of total freedom and should be kept as such, because that freedom is something that we have lost outside of it in the world of the material, right? Because remember, separation of information from matter is a primary trope here. So that idea of cyber liberty is born. And it's described very well by this quip from Stuart Brand from 1985. And Stuart Brand is actually a fascinating figure who was really popular in California and in the Western United States long before the internet appeared, because he's the founder of the whole Earth Catalog, which is a catalog of all sorts of useful knowledge that he was printing and distributing, which later became one of the first bulletin board systems and became known as the Well Network. So he's a kind of prophetic figure when it comes to the early cyber culture and the appearance of a lot of these tropes. And he describes in 1985 the key principles of this network as follows. Information wants to be free, but it also wants to be expensive. And what he means here is that naturally information wants to be expensive because it's always valuable to have the right information at the right time. But at the same time, information wants to be free because the network is designed in such a way that information can flow everywhere, right? And it wants to be able to flow everywhere. Otherwise, we don't have a network. Otherwise, we don't have cyberspace. So here we have a dilemma. On the one hand, information can flow everywhere, and can self-replicate everywhere, but on the other hand, valuable information is the type which you need right now, right? And this, there is value, there's tremendous value in that ability to get the right information at the right time. That same year, 1985, so remember, this 1 year after Neuromancer is published, 1 year after the first Apple graphical user interface computer is published, Richard Stallman, who is the founder of the free/liber open source movement, tremendously important figure in the history of the internet. This is the year in which he publishes the GNU Manifesto, which is the manifesto of the open source movement as such. And it's worth quoting him at length. I consider that the golden rule requires that if I like a program, I must share it with other people who like it. Software sellers want to divide the users and conquer them, making each user agree not to share with others. I refuse to break solidarity with other users in this way. I cannot in good conscience sign a non-disclosure agreement or a software license agreement. So that I can continue to use computers without dishonor, I have decided to put together a sufficient body of free software so that I will be able to get along without any software that is not free. Right? So how does what does he do here? Right? So he defines a type of software which is free as opposed to software which is not free. And what is free software? Software that you can share with other people who might want to use it. Software that you can manipulate at will, share at will. Software that acts much more like an idea than like a piece of commodity or furniture or whatever, right? So he introduces a distinction of fundamental importance. This distinction, by the way, gave rise to the free and open source movement and to open source software as we know it today, the Linux operating system, the Android operating system, which runs all Android phones on the planet, and a myriad of other examples, right? Most of the key infrastructure that actually runs the internet runs on open source software, right? Without that software, we literally have no internet. 6 years later, on the 6th of August 1991, key historical date, Tim Berners-Lee, a researcher at that time at CERN in Switzerland, shares the World Wide Web protocols globally as a free and open source protocol, and therefore the World Wide Web is born, right? What all of us using the internet actually call the internet, right? The World Wide Web. And this is how he describes it. The project started with the philosophy that much academic information should be freely available to anyone, right? So this is all about freely available information, making information accessible to everyone, making knowledge accessible. It aims to allow information sharing within internationally dispersed teams and the dissemination of information by support groups, right? It's all about the free flow of information. Here he is again talking about the World Wide Web. The web is more a social creation than a technical one. I designed it for social effect, to help people work together and not as a technical toy. The ultimate goal of the web is to support and improve our web-like existence in the world. It's a social creation, right? So here we have the parameters emerging of cyberspace as a space of freedom. And that freedom is freedom of ideas, freedom of knowledge. Right? This is how it was conceptualized and imagined and designed by these visionaries of the early internet, right? And of the early World Wide Web. Another early visionary who was one of the key editors of Wired magazine, Kevin Kelly, writes in Out of Control in 1994, "So far, nearly everything about the actual possibility space which computers have created indicates they are the end of authority and not its beginning." Right? So this is also cyber liberty is imagined against authority, against the limitations on knowledge liberty, as one could imagine, as imposed by authority. And Kevin Kelly sees in his imaginary of cyberspace, of the internet, sees a merger of that space with human culture, with human society. Right? So he sees this as an inevitability, and this is a really important trope to which we will return. Silicon chips linked into high bandwidth channels are the neurons of our culture. So again, we have this, the idea of the global brain, which first emerged with the telegraph. Our firms and organization resemble blobs. Now, by the enabling invention of silicon and glass neurons, boom, an infinite variety of new shapes and sizes of social organizations are suddenly possible. We are about to witness an explosion of entities built on relationships and technology that rival the early days of life on Earth in their variety. So we're seeing here a celebration of the internet as literally a renaissance, a rebirth of humanity as a species and capable of culture. And this new culture is going to be merged with these silicon chips and high bandwidth channels, right? It's a merger of human culture and cyberspace. And we have in 1994, again, Esther Dyson and George Gilder, George Kayward, Alvin Toffler declaring that cyberspace is the latest American frontier. And that's there's a finality to this statement, because the American frontier is this imaginary, it's a metaphor for freedom, metaphor for opportunity, metaphor for limitless expansion, metaphor in many respects for individual sovereignty. And this cyber liberty framework, right, which emerges together with cyberpunk, and is these are the two early cultural tropes of cyberspace and of the emergent internet, is probably best encapsulated by John Perry Barlow in his Declaration of the Independence of Cyberspace, which, when read now, sounds to many ears as a tremendously naive cyber utopian statement. But I think nothing could be further from the truth. This is a really important, a really prophetic vision of the power of the internet, of the power of this new society, this new network society paradigm, and of its tremendous potential. So let's see what John Perry Barlow said, and this is not the whole declaration, these are just extracts. "You weary giants of flesh and steel," he's addressing states and corporations here, "I come from cyberspace, the new home of mind. On behalf of the future, I ask you of the past to leave us alone. You are not welcome among us. You have no sovereignty where we got." So this is a radical declaration here, right? This is a radical declaration of independence, right? We don't want you around us. Leave us alone. He's addressing states and corporations. "Ours is a world that is both everywhere and nowhere, but it is not where bodies live," right? So this is not a material world. "We will create a civilization of the mind in cyberspace." We will return again to this declaration because it's of tremendous importance for the development of the internet, its evolution and continuous expansion and continuous iterations. So we mapped the cyberpunk tropes, so let's look at the cyber liberty tropes. We have above all information freedom, knowledge freedom, cold freedom. We have this call and presumption for the end of regulation. The state has no business being involved in cyberspace. We have this notion of the electronic frontier, the state being irrelevant, the state being the enemy, in fact, of cyberspace. Individual sovereignty, right? The individual node, the node that can communicate with all and process information, is sovereign, fully independent, end of authority. The node is private as well. So we have a lot of tropes which are all, in fact, with us today, 20 years later, already operating when it comes to these early cyber liberty visions of the internet and of cyberspace. And as Manuel Castells points out in his book, The Network Society, A Cross-Cultural Perspective, the culture of freedom was decisive to induce network technologies that in turn were the essential infrastructure for business to operate in terms of globalization, decentralization, and networking. Right? So these cultures of freedom were fundamental in the way the internet continued to develop. Only then the knowledge-based economy could function at its full potential, because data, minds, bodies and material production could be related in real time in a continuous interactive network. So this brings us, having moved from the emergent paradigm of the global nervous system through that shift from centralized to distributed control, through the emergence of this cultural phenomenon of cyberspace as a frontier, and cyberpunk and the cyber liberty imaginaries, to that concept of the network society. So we are now at the final stage of my lecture, where we're trying to map how all of this actually comes together into a network society paradigm in which we all now live. So the network society is described by Manuel Castells as a society whose social structure is made of networks powered by microelectronics based information and communication technologies. And this Manuel Castells is not John Perry Barlow, obviously, so this is a very dry academic statement, but it is of tremendous power, because what he actually is saying is that the social structure of who we are, right, the structure of our societies, of the way we actually operate as communities, is made of information networks now. So information networks are literally the building blocks of who we are today. This is what the network society is. It's us plus our information networks. And this is unprecedented, right? So this is a completely new form of organization for our species, for the human species as such. That is why it's so important to understand the evolution that we've undergone over the last 150 years, from the arrival of the telegraph to where we are today. And in 1991, when the World Wide Web is just starting, Phil Salen is declaring that by 2000, multiple cyberspaces will have emerged, diverse and increasingly rich. Contrary to naive views, these cyberspaces will not all be the same, and they will not all be open to the general public. The global network is a connected platform for a collection of diverse communities, but only a loose, heterogeneous community itself. So we have a network society which is built from a vast number of smaller, diverse, heterogeneous communities, which may or may not be open to everyone else, to publics. So this society is global by definition, because digital networks are global and they know no boundaries in their capacity to reconfigure themselves, right, as Manuel Castells declares. So the network society is a social structure whose infrastructure is based on digital networks, and therefore by definition it is global. The network society is a global society by definition, right? It spans the entire globe. And again, I return you to telegraph trope of nerves of iron wire spanning the globe. Here we have, 150 years later, this being framed already as the defining characteristic of an emergent paradigm, of our emergent way of being in the world, as part of a global network society. And this network society is characterized by a knowledge economy, is characterized by an economy based on information. And this is framed very well by authors we've already encountered early in the lecture, Esther Dyson, Alvin Toffler, etc., in their formulation of this shift between economies. And the way they describe it is really interesting. In a first wave economy, land and farm labor are the main factors of production, right? So we have a paradigm based on agricultural production. In the second wave economy is industrial. Land remains valuable while the labor becomes massified around machines and larger industries. In a third wave economy, however, what the economy in which we are now, in, right? It's a network society economy. The central resource, a single word broadly encompassing data, information, images, symbols, culture, ideology, and values, is actionable knowledge, right? So we've moved from land to machines and the assembly line to actionable knowledge, right? So this is the other defining characteristic of the network society. The fact that its central resource, its most valuable resource, is information and actionable knowledge. It's immaterial. The right information combined with the right software and presentation at precisely the right time. Unlike the mass knowledge of the second wave, third wave customized knowledge is by nature a private good. It's by nature valuable, therefore becomes a private good, right? This is what's really important to understand here, that information, this is exactly what Stuart Brand means when he says the information wants to be free, but it also wants to be expensive. Why? Because the right information combined with the right software and presentation at precisely the right time is expensive. It's tremendously valuable. On top of that, Manuel Castells describes the network society as working on the basis of a binary logic of inclusion and exclusion, whose boundaries change over time, both with the changes in the network's programs and with the conditions of performance of these programs. And this sounds quite cryptic, but actually what he means is that this kind of society really has two states when it comes to individual nodes, to individuals. So you're either part of the network, in which case you can partake in the information flows and processing, and you can be a node of various importance, or you're not part of the network, in which case you do not exist. Right? So this is also, we see here an extension of this logic of control and coordination, because if you are part of that network, you can exercise to some extent control and coordination over information flows. You can participate in the sorting of information in cyberspace as part of that network. Because remember, the social structure itself has merged with the information network. Not so if you are not part of it. Hence, a binary logic of inclusion and exclusion. This has tremendous importance, and it's really important that you understand this thoroughly, because this has tremendous importance when it comes to power relationships. Because if someone is excluded from participating in the network, that someone is completely and utterly disempowered. And they have no power over themselves even. They are on the receiving end of the network while not actually participating in it. Hence, binary logic of inclusion and exclusion. And finally, and most importantly, because the central resource, the central source of value for the network society is information, the information mongers, the media, are the key networks. Because, as Castells points out, the media organizing global oligopolies of and their distributive networks are the primary sources of messages and images that reach people's minds. And as we know, cyberspace is where it is in the mind. Hence, the networks that have direct access to the mind are the networks that wield the most power in this paradigm. And these are the media networks, understood in the broadest sense. And here you have it. Here we have now the full parameters of the network society paradigm. We have the fact that information is decoupled from matter, the fact that it compresses space and time, homogenizes them, the fact that this is global at all times, at all points, and the fact that it allows real-time coordination and control. And the emergence of this paradigm leads to where we are now. And what we have is a society where the social structure itself, right, so this is the fabric from which the society is made of information networks. And we have a vast multiplicity of these different information networks, all forming that meta network that we call the internet. the internet, these information networks merged as they are with the social structure that makes society, the network society, generates that ephemeral concept that we call cyberspace, and that Esther Dyson actually framed as a global bioelectronic environment. Bio because it involves us, our bodies, literally, and electronic because it uses electronic communication. The central resource of this society is actionable knowledge, right? Knowledge that can allow action at the right time in the right place. And knowledge is nothing more than synthesized and systematized information, data, which flows across those networks forming a global bioelectronic environment. The network society is characterized by a binary logic of inclusion and exclusion. You either are in the network, in which case you have some sort of power depending on your exact position within the networks forming the network, or you are outside, in which case you have no power, you're completely disempowered and on the receiving end of the network. And the strategic space where, in fact, all battles within the network society are performed is people's minds. So this is the first time in our, as far as we know, history as a species in which the strategic space of power is in the mind. So this frames everything that is to come in our discussions of the internet and in our discussions of the network society in general and in of cyberspace as that metaphorical space first conceptualized by William Gibson. All right, so this pretty much wraps up the lecture. If you have any questions, remember to ask me on Twitter at TedMeetYou. Thank you very much for listening and see you online.